Hi, everyone. Thank you so much for being here today and for leading the charge for an America and a world that works for all of us. And thank you for giving such a powerful voice to this movement through your work in Bernie's campaign. We're here today to ensure that your work will continue until we prevail, however long it takes. And we won't let sabotage by the Democratic Party stop the Bernie movement. As he said, it's a movement, not a man, and you've come too far to turn back now. We've seen the true colors of the Democratic Party this past year, the superdelegates and the Super Tuesdays designed to undermine political power for the grassroots. We've seen the stripping of voter rolls in Brooklyn, the manipulation of rules at the Nevada convention, and the failure to count millions of votes in California. What the Democrats did to Bernie, they've done to every truly progressive presidential candidate for decades, from Jesse Jackson to Dennis Kucinich. So for those who've been watchdogging the Democrats, the attack on Bernie, sadly, was expected. What many people have learned this year is that you can't have a revolutionary campaign in a counter-revolutionary party. So to keep the revolution going, I invite you to join our presidential campaign, a campaign for people, planet, and peace over profit. And together, we can build inside of a party that will lift us up, not push us down. And we can build a united party for the 99%, bringing together the people's parties that refuse to be poisoned by corporate money, lobbyists, and super PACs. That means the Green Party, Socialist Alternative, the ISO, Peace and Freedom, Labor, the Bernie Movement, and others. And we'll be joining together with activists that have never been connected to political parties before. Together, we will be an unstoppable force. In fact, we already are an unstoppable force, which they don't want you to know about. But as Alice Walker said, the biggest way people give up power is by not knowing we have it to start with. Well, we have it, and we're going to use it, and here's how. 43 million young people, and not so young people, are locked into predatory student loan debt. And that is a winning number in a three-way presidential race. And there's only one candidate that will cancel that debt, and you are looking at her right now. If the political elites bailed out the crooks on Wall Street, it's time to bail out the young people who are the victims of that waste, fraud, and abuse on Wall Street. The good news is that this doesn't have to go through Congress, because it's the Federal Reserve that has the power to cancel that debt, which is how they bailed out Wall Street. And the chair of the Federal Reserve is appointed by, guess who? The president. So by coming out to vote on Election Day, millennials and student debtors can take over this election and win it. And not just to cancel student debt, but also to make public higher education free, which pays for itself, because every taxpayer dollar put into higher education generates $7 in return in revenue and public benefits. We know that from the GI Bill after the Second World War. And we can create an emergency jobs program to solve the emergency climate crisis. We call this a Green New Deal, like the New Deal that got us out of the Great Depression. It'll create 20 million good wage jobs to give everyone a job so we can transform our energy, our food, and our transportation systems to achieve 100% clean renewable energy by 2030. It will revive our economy, it'll make wars for oil obsolete, and it pays for itself in healthcare savings from preventing much of the burden of diseases linked to fossil fuels. That means asthma, cancers, heart attacks, and strokes. And there's another emergency that we can and must fix. We can end police violence and brutality against black lives. Just this week, our hearts are breaking once again with the latest cases of unprovoked police assault and murder. adding Alston Sterling and Philando Castile to the list of tragic assassinations, along with Freddie Gray and Eric Garner, Walter Scott, Tamar Rice, Sandra Bland, and the list goes on and on. We need police review boards and full-time investigators to look into all deaths at the hands of police so that communities control their police and not have police controlling their communities. We must demilitarize the police, end the war, the racist war on drugs, and invest in jobs and education, not war and incarceration. And it's time to create a Truth and Reconciliation Commission to address the living legacy of slavery, which brings unconscionable racial disparities to virtually all dimensions of our lives and society, jobs and schools and housing and health, with real life and death consequences from those disparities. So it's time to affirm both our words and our actions that Black lives do matter. And we can also create healthcare as a human right, a welcoming path to citizenship, and a foreign policy based on international law, human rights, and diplomacy, not on military and economic domination that has been such a catastrophic failure. So, this is the world that we can create outside of the two corporate political parties funded by predatory banks, fossil fuel giants, and war profiteers. So it's time to vote for what we want, not against what we fear. Because that politics of fear has actually delivered everything we were afraid of. All those reasons you were told to vote for the lesser evil, because you didn't want the massive Wall Street bailouts, the offshoring of our jobs, the meltdown of the climate, endless war, the attack on immigrant rights and civil liberties, all of that we've gotten by the droves, and much of it under a Democratic White House and two Democratic Houses of Congress, because we allowed ourselves to be silenced and to let the lesser evil speak for us. But the lesser evil actually paves the way to the greater evil, because people stop coming out to vote for politicians that are throwing us under the bus. In fact, the surge of support behind Donald Trump is a direct result of the economic misery created by the neoliberal policies passed by Bill Clinton with Hillary's full support. Those are Wall Street deregulation, leading to the 2008 crash that destroyed 9 million jobs and foreclosed 5 million homes, and it's NAFTA, which exported another million jobs. So the bottom line is another Clinton in the White House will fan the flames of the right-wing extremism supporting Donald Trump. It's not gonna fix it. The only way to fight this is with truly revolutionary progressive policies, with a mass social movement and a revolutionary political party. So thank you for the historic work that you've already done to make that happen. And thank you for being here today to continue that work. I hope you will go to jill2016.com or to my social media at Dr. Jill Stein and join the team, volunteer, help with the petition drive, make a financial contribution if you can. I'm so honored to be working with you and with Kshama Sawant and Socialist Alternative and the ISO and the Greens and all the other progressives and activists, so that together we can build a unified party and an unstoppable force. As part of that work, I hope you will come to Philadelphia for the Democratic National Convention. And among the events there, come with us on July 25th, that's Monday, for the March for Our Lives, starting at 3 o'clock at City Hall, in which we will march right up to our campaign's Power to the People rally at the park directly across from the convention center. In this race, we're not only deciding what kind of a world we will have, but in fact, whether we will have a world or not. Between the new nuclear arms race, the climate meltdown, the expanding wars, It's become a race to the bottom between the greater evil and the lesser evil, and the clock is ticking. Democracy needs a moral compass, and we ourselves are the ones who will provide it. If we silence ourselves, we create a moral vacuum in which the corporate predators rush in. So it's time to stand up. We are the ones we've been waiting for. It's time to forget the lesser evil and fight for the greater good, like our lives depend on it, because they do. We can have an America and a world that works for all of us, that puts people, planet, and peace over profit. The power to create that world is not just in our hopes, it's not just in our dreams. Right here and now, it's in our hands. Thank you so much for making it so.
Sisters and brothers, it is no exaggeration to say that we are at one of the most dramatic turning points in the history of global capitalism. Everywhere, the old social and political order is fragmenting, and a new generation is rising up to demand a different world. And here in the United States, in the belly of the beast, the two-party system is facing an almost unprecedented crisis of legitimacy. For over 150 years, the American ruling class has boasted the most stable capitalist political system, the greatest democracy in the world, they used to say. Historically, the Republican and Democratic parties were two of the most powerful and reliable instruments of the capitalist class, deeply integrated into the imperial state machinery that has dominated and exploited the whole world for generations. But after presiding over three decades of rising inequality and social decay, in the face of the deepest crisis of world capitalism since the 1930s, all of that is unraveling. On the one hand, the degeneration of the old Republican big business leadership has reached such a level of corruption that even a right populist blowhard like Donald Trump could swoop in and with one blow knock their crumbling house down. On the other hand, while Clinton narrowly prevailed over Sanders, this was only accomplished at the expense of exposing the deeply undemocratic machinery of the Democratic Party primaries, at the expense of exposing the naked bias of the corporate media, and at the expense of further exposing Wall Street's stranglehold over US politics. Hillary Clinton may have survived the primary battle, but the neoliberal clique of the New Democrats that have dominated the party since Bill Clinton's 1992 victory are starting to lose the war. Hillary has emerged as the least trusted, least popular major party candidate in modern history, with only Trump topping her historic unfavorability ratings. Bernie's political revolution has aroused millions to the potential for a completely different kind of politics. Millions now see that it is possible, without taking a dime of corporate cash, for a truly people-powered political revolution and movement to challenge the corporate establishment for power. The idea that there is no alternative to capitalism, that the system is invincible, is gone. And the specter of socialism has returned, with a new generation now discussing a socialist-inspired vision for transforming society. The idea of building a broad new political party to unite the 99% against the corporate duopoly is also rapidly gaining popularity. Historians may look back on the Bernie Sanders campaign and 2016 generally as a turning point in US politics, as the beginning of the end of the US two-party system. And we are all. We, my sisters and brothers, are not passive bystanders in this historic moment. We are active participants of this movement, but, sisters and brothers, nothing is automatic. Our movement is now at a very definite crossroads. A debate has been raging among Bernie's Sandernistas over whether to follow Bernie into the Democratic Party to attempt a transformation from within, or to back Green Party candidate Jill Stein and continue the political revolution by building an independent mass movement for a political alternative. We in Socialist Alternative supported Bernie's campaign from the beginning, but we made no secret that we had fundamental disagreements with Sanders, especially on his decision, as Jill Stein has so eloquently put it, to attempt a political revolution from within a counter-revolutionary party. And as everyone knows, Sanders has just endorsed Hillary Clinton on Tuesday at her rally in New Hampshire. Emotions are running high, and we need to have respectful discussions in the coming days. We need to have a patient, understanding approach with people who have strong personal attachments to Sanders, and also with those who say they will be voting for Clinton to stop Trump. In some cases, we will have to respectfully agree to disagree and continue the discussion later. But we also need to call things by their real names and not gloss over what has happened. We should be clear. What Sanders has done by endorsing Clinton is not just a tactic or not merely a mistake. Whatever his intentions, by endorsing a candidate of Wall Street, by backing a party controlled by big business, Sanders has abandoned our revolution. He has endorsed the epitome of neoliberal politics in Hillary Clinton. By doing so, he is attempting to turn his political revolution into its opposite. He is now using his considerable authority with tens of millions of people to funnel them back into the corporate Democratic Party and attempting to surrender our movement to the same establishment that we have been fighting against. Millions of Sanders supporters, nearly half in some polls, say they will not vote for Clinton. Bernie has correctly and repeatedly said, not me, us. But by endorsing Clinton, he has forgotten that message. Our movement had no say in this. Sanders refused to even meet with Jill Stein. He refused to even organize a real debate within the movement. We recognize the historic success of his campaign so far, and he himself has played no small role in that. But we cannot confuse the individual with the movement. It is time for our movement to move on. Our movement cannot follow Bernie into the lair of Wall Street and the billionaire class. As recent polls confirm, the Democratic Party has consciously chosen to not back the strongest campaign against Donald Trump. The latest polling shows Hillary Clinton and Donald Trump tied, deadlocked in the polls. This is an early reading. Admittedly, things could change, but it is revealing, nonetheless, of just how fiercely the Democratic Party opposes our grassroots movement, that they will choose this weak, corrupt candidate, Hillary Clinton, as an opponent against Donald Trump. While Sanders has again and again shown that he could trounce Trump in November. But this is not accidental. The Democratic Party and its billionaire backers are quite simply more afraid of our political revolution than they are of Trump. They don't want our power to grow, and they are prepared to risk a right-wing racist president. But if that happens, let us be clear, this is on them. Sanders also says he supports Clinton because he wants to defeat Trump. While there can be no doubt about Bernie's diagnosis of the threat represented by Trump's right-wing populism, he is entirely wrong about how to cure the disease. We will not succeed in decisively defeating the right by supporting establishment politicians like Hillary Clinton. It is the massive outrage at the brutal big business policies carried out by the political establishment that has created the basis for Trump's ascendancy in the first place. We saw this very clearly. Trump is not the first phenomenon. We saw this clearly a few years ago when we witnessed the rise of the Tea Party, which was born out of the fury at the Wall Street bailouts, while the left was busy making excuses for Obama's pro-corporate policies. Socialist Alternative and I are endorsing Green Party candidate Jill Stein for president. Jill is fighting on essentially all the same issues that brought millions around Bernie. She is calling for Medicare for all, a $15 minimum wage nationally, and an end to mass incarceration, as you heard her say. There can be no doubt in our minds at this moment that Jill's campaign is the clear continuation of our political revolution and deserves the broadest possible support from all of us. Not surprisingly, Clinton supporters and the neoliberal establishment have begun a campaign of fear against our call for a left-wing political alternative by preemptively blaming us for the threat of a Trump presidency. Just like they tried to blame the 3 million people who voted for Ralph Nader in 2000 for George Bush's presidency and the invasion of Iraq. But sisters and brothers, we know the truth. It was the brutal neoliberal politics of Bill Clinton and the New Democrats that cost Al Gore the presidency. It was the complicity of the whole Democratic Party, including Hillary Clinton, that paved the way for the bloody invasion and occupation of Iraq. First, they rigged the electoral system against any anti-establishment working class challenge to the capitalist parties. Then, they blame working people for voting wrong when the Republicans win in this warped electoral system. First, the Democratic Party embraces an agenda of deregulating Wall Street, of endless war, of free trade disasters, of budget cuts and union busting, of mass incarceration and structural racism. Then they blame working people they have ruthlessly betrayed for refusing to vote again for their false promises. It is not we who are responsible for the rise of right-wing populism, for the racist and anti-immigrant appeal of Donald Trump. It is the neoliberal pro-corporate policies and obvious corruption of both the Republican and Democratic parties. We have repeatedly warned collapsing our movement behind Clinton's Wall Street campaign would not only sabotage the political revolution, it would not only mean derailing the incredible momentum we have built over the past year, but it would also help right-wing populists like Trump to gain strength. As we've already seen, if the left continues to fail to offer a fighting alternative, the mass anger fueling the global anti-establishment revolt can be channeled behind right-wing nationalist forces. Even, and this is what we should truly watch out for, even if Trump loses the election, the right-wing forces behind him will emerge strengthened, emboldened, and better organized if we do not build our movement now. We cannot let that happen. We cannot allow ourselves to be bullied into the same bankrupt, lesser evil political logic that has brought us to this moment of crisis. For the left to win the things we have all been fighting for, we will need to build a powerful mass movement based on political independence from the two parties of neoliberalism. And this year, we need to use Jill Stein's campaign and this historic moment to prepare the ground for a new mass party to unite the 99% against the 1%. Imagine the emergence of a broad movement-based political party in this country, bringing together socialists, Greens, left trade unions, Black Lives Matter activists, immigrants, women's rights activists, the LGBTQ movement, environmentalists, and the millions of working people searching for a left alternative. Such a party would not just be an electoral project, but would become an organizing center. It would work with our movements, not against them. A mass party of working people, completely independent of corporate money and influence, would help raise class consciousness. It would help reinforce the idea that working people have common interests across the divides of race, national origin, and gender identity. It would also, crucially, help make clear that as working people, we have no interest in common with the billionaire class who have used our economy, politics, and even culture to meet their narrow agenda of greed and profit. A broad mass party of the 99% would create a crucial space for the left to debate the strategy and program needed to end poverty, war, racism, and environmental catastrophe, to debate whether this can even be accomplished within the framework of capitalism or whether a socialist transformation of society is needed. And within this broad party for workers, Socialist Alternative would campaign for the idea of taking the top 500 corporations under public ownership and democratic workers' control. We would campaign to replace the destructive, profit-driven capitalist economy with a democratically planned socialist economy based on the needs of humanity and the planet. One of the most important achievements of the Sanders campaign was to reopen a mass debate on socialist ideas and on how we can change society. But we have fundamental differences with Bernie on the meaning of socialism. We do not think that capitalism can be reformed. Capitalism is a system based on massive inequalities and environmental destruction. We need a society based on equality, sustainability, and solidarity. As Bernie himself said, winning a political revolution will take a movement of millions and must be about more than any single candidate or any single election. In that spirit, we say it is time to move beyond Bernie. It is time for the movement that began his presidential campaign to learn to be independent and choose for itself a path forward. This will not happen overnight, but we also must have a sense of urgency. Movements are endangered that do not learn to walk on their own. They can be misled, they can be sold out, they can miss historic opportunities like the one we have today. Last December, Socialist Alternative and I launched Movement for Bernie to independently campaign for Sanders. While always being upfront about our differences, we recognized the huge potential of the movement behind Bernie to challenge the billionaire class. But now it is time for a new name for our new movement. We will be relaunching Movement for Bernie as Movement for the 99%. Bernie is turning toward the Democratic Party, and we, the 99%, are turning toward political independence. Mobilizing from the 120,000 people who signed our petition calling for building a political alternative to the Democrats, we have organized dozens of meetings around the country, just like this one, to announce the launch of the Movement for the 99% and to discuss our next steps. And in just a few weeks, there will be mass protests outside the Democratic National Convention in Philadelphia. Socialist Alternative will be there with Movement for the 99% activists, with Jill Stein, with Bernie or Bust, and many others to demand an end to the corporate stranglehold over our democracy. We will be there calling for a vote for Stein, for launching a united mass party for the 99%, and to build support for a socialist alternative to this rotten system. I hope that today we will have provoked an important discussion. And if you agree with our ideas, I hope that you will join my organization, Socialist Alternative, and I look forward to seeing you all Seattleites in Philly in a few days. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Mel Lyman. I'm an academic, and so I tend to look at the world partly through my academic background, but aware of the integration of action and thought. And it reminds me of the debate that went on in my circle. I'm 90 years old, so it's a long circle. It was over the difference between reform and revolution. And I think it's something that you ought to keep in mind. The function of a reform is to forestall revolution by offering part of what you're searching for. That's the function of it. But There's something that goes well beyond that, and I see that as a transition here. And that is that participation in the process of struggling for a reform is open-ended. It's potentially revolutionary, because the process of struggle is what alters consciousness. And
30 more seconds.
Okay. And I think if you keep that in mind in analyzing some of the day-to-day struggle, which is so crucial, that you'll be prepared for short-term losses and hopefully long-term gains. Because what you need to get at is the essence of capitalism, that it is an instrument of exploitation.
Hi there, my name is Cindy Black. I work with WAMEND. We're the Washington Coalition to Amend the Constitution. We are going after the big pie. We're trying to get a constitutional amendment that says, first and foremost, that corporations are not people. Money does not equal free speech. And all political contributions should be made public and regulated by any local municipality. And we know that the Supreme Court has gone way overboard. Justice Ginsburg has come out against and said one of the only ways to basically overturn or end Citizens United and all the other Supreme Court decisions like McCutcheon and all the ones that go back way back to the late 1800s is a constitutional amendment. So we have Initiative 735 on the ballot here in Washington State. We would be the 18th state calling for this. So this is a national movement, and here in Washington State, we are part of a national movement. California is also going to be on the ballot. So we just want to encourage everybody to please support Initiative 735. Vote yes on it. Encourage all your friends, family, neighbors. We want to pass this thing big and send a strong message to our legislators that they no longer can run the show anymore. It's up to us. Thank you.
I'm Jody Grage. I'm on the Coordinating Council for the Green Party of Washington State. I'm only 80, but you know, I have good genes. You're not going to get rid of me early. I'm also a Capricorn, and I want to give you one practical bit of information. In Washington State, the only thing anyone's vote has to do with is our 12 Electoral College votes. Every 4 years, the party say, oh, you got to vote for us or the other guy will get it. What I tell people is, if you like what the Democrats are doing, vote for them. If you don't like what they're doing, don't vote for them. I mean, because the 12 Electoral College votes in Washington State are going to the Democrats. You could bet your fortune if you had one on it. So if you don't like what they're doing and you vote for them, they're going to think you like what they are doing and they are not going to change. So when someone tells you that they have to vote for the Democrat or the Republican will get them, you just feed them that little thing and get them to figure out that if you don't like what the Democrats are doing and you vote for them, that is truly a wasted vote. And if you want more information on Jill's campaign, we have these four-ups and we have sign-up sheets back there. And we will be more than happy to put you to work. Anyone who knows me knows that I am good at putting people to work.
Good evening, everybody. I'm Dan Smith. I decided to run for Congress because Bernie, thankfully, woke my ass up. I am running again in the 9th district against Adam Smith, a 20-year establishment neoliberal who has helped to maintain and create this curve of our productivity continues to go up and our wages stay flat, and all that gap in between, that increasing spread, goes off to the executives and the CEOs and the corporations as profit. I want that gone. Adam Smith is not a bad guy, but this is not a campaign speech. I was in the back talking about Bernie with Mira earlier, and not to throw you under the bus, Mira, I think you're right about so much stuff, it's awesome. But at the same time, I want to say that what we disagreed on was Bernie stands for what he stands for, and nothing changed from yesterday to today. He decided to run as a Democrat. That means he was dealt his cards from a deck, and he must play them. So when he does his endorsement, sad as it is, he would not be allowed to speak. He would not be allowed. There's certain things he would have been blocked from, and so he's got to play the game. As hurtful and as sad as it is, it's not a slam on us. For people I'm seeing on my Facebook page and friends I'm talking to in the street, they're saying, no more, I'm done, that's awful. 35, 40 years on, Bernie's doing the same thing and saying the same thing, and yet we're ready to dump. I don't like it, I don't believe it, it's not the right way to be. Please consider me in the election. You just got the voters pamphlet. Guys, have a good movement going.
Hello, everyone. My name is Wesley Irwin, and I am running for State House position number 2 in the Legislative District 32nd Legislative District. My campaign is to elect an educator for the legislature. I have a long history in education. In fact, I brought Kshama Sawant to speak at North Seattle Community College and almost lost my job for it because the president was against socialism. So, yeah, pretty wild. But I went on to work for the Bernie Sanders campaign, paid staff for Bernie Sanders, and I have to echo some of the comments of the previous speaker that I think that Bernie was really between a rock and a hard place. I still support the fact that it's possible that he could still take the nomination, as FDR actually endorsed his opponent and took the nomination in 1932. So it's very important that we're all in Philly. It's extremely important that we're all in Philly. As far as my campaign goes, and echoing some of the things that have been said here tonight, I'm against corporate Democrats. I'm running against one. Her name is Ruth Kagey. And I want to make sure that we put an end to charter schools in Washington State. Ruth Kagey just voted against the Democratic Party platform, and more importantly, the Washington State Constitution, in voting for charter schools. And so I want to make sure that we are not using public fund to finance rich kids' privatized education. Anyway, thank you. I appreciate that. My website is wesleyirwinforstatehouse.com. I would appreciate your support. Look forward to speaking with all of you. Thank you.
My name's Calvin. I'm with Socialist Alternative. I think some important things have been brought up. I think it takes a while to process when something like this happens. But I do think that it matters what we do right now, and I do think it matters what conclusions we draw from what's taking place. I do think we all should go to Philadelphia if we can. I mean, I think there's going to be historic protests at Philadelphia, and we have a real opportunity in Philadelphia to fight for Jill Stein's campaign, to fight to build a united party of the 99%, to fight to continue the political revolution. One of the things that's going to happen in Philadelphia is, in my understanding, some of the delegates are organizing a walkout. The bigger that walkout is, the more of an impact it's going to have on what we do going forward. But part of the conclusions that need to be drawn for that walkout to be big is that this isn't about Bernie, it's about us. And so if Bernie makes a mistake and he endorses Hillary, the question is, do people follow him, whatever he says at the convention, or don't they? Because if he says to vote for Hillary, they shouldn't. And when Hillary comes up to speak, they should walk out. So we do have to differentiate between the individual and our movement. And Bernie played a central role. There's no question about that. I mean, I think Occupy started it. I think the 99% started it. But he's played a central role over this last year, and that's fine, and that's great. But we have to also be able to differentiate, and we need to decide what we're doing going forward. Our movement has to decide. We can't accept that we're going to support Hillary Clinton, the Democratic Party, And we have to have those discussions over the next weeks. It's going to take some people, I think, longer to decide. But I think the stronger we are in Philadelphia and the stronger we are over these coming months and the stronger Jill Stein's campaign is, the more we're going to be able to win the things that we fought for over this past year, and that's what matters.
I think the central question that faces us, I mean, there's obviously the discussion touched on many different aspects, but I think the central and the most urgent question that faces us, what should we do this year? I think it's easier for us to duck the question. I'm not saying we should. I'm saying we shouldn't duck. But it would be easier to duck the question of what we should do this year now that Bernie has lost and just talk about socialism or about how we can change society in more abstract terms. But we have to learn the lessons from history and understand that the gains that were won in the past that we stand on were not won by ducking the most urgent questions of the day. They were won, the gains that were won in terms of women's rights, in terms of the question of race, the question of environmental protection. Everything that we have seen that brought about progressive social change, none of that was established by the activists of that era saying, well, I want to stay neutral about this question, or I'm okay if people vote for the corporate Democrat, but I'm going to be keep building the movement. That's such a building of the movement is a myth. That is not how movements build. Movements build by taking on the power of corporations and saying, we defy you, and we will build independent of you. And so let's be very concrete. You know, let's learn concrete lessons from history. You know, Bernie loves to talk about Scandinavian countries and Canada and how they won healthcare, and he's correct. I mean, if we had that kind of healthcare, even though there's many attacks on those public systems now, but if the American working families had had that kind of healthcare, our quality of life would have been significantly better. So that is worth fighting for. Single-payer healthcare or Medicare for all is worth fighting for. But let's look at how Canada, for example, won single-payer healthcare. They did not win single-payer healthcare by decades ago saying, we're going to accept the logic of lesser evilism and just go along. And then somewhere in the distant horizon, the more liberal party that existed at that time would somehow come through and give us healthcare, and that's how they got healthcare. No, the reason they won it is because at that time, many decades ago, the labor movement, the left, the socialists in Canada decided that if they were to get anywhere in terms of winning social change, they had to build independent of the establishment parties, which is precisely what they did by building the New Democratic Party, winning healthcare in a province, and that taking over the imagination of working people in Canada everywhere around the country and demanding that they wanted that too. And that kind of popularity that was gained by that independent party terrified the establishment parties, and they ended up passing single-payer healthcare nationally because they knew that the writing was on the wall, that this new party had shown how to succeed, and if they didn't actually deliver on single-payer healthcare, their, you know, death warrants, political death warrants were written. And that is how they won it. And if you look at what we've done in Seattle, how did we win 15? We did not win $15 an hour by accepting the limitations of the corporate Democrats on the city council. We built a movement in defiance of them. And the election of a socialist, and it's not the individual that's important, it's the phenomenon of electing an independent, working class, anti-corporate, pro-working people candidate. That election victory was not incidental to the victory of $15 an hour. It was the central component of why we won 15, because we built a movement together that sent the message to big business that we are serious about winning $15 an hour. And as soon as we won the election, we built the 15 Now campaign. And through the 15 Now campaign, we went around the city educating workers why they should fight for 15, why this was not going to be apocalyptic, as the right wing was saying for Seattle and why they should join the socialists in this fight and why the labor movement should fight for this, even though not a single Democrat was willing really to stand unambiguously in favor of 15. But what happened at the end of the day? When we started, every corporate media outlet was saying, this is never going to happen, this is a pipe dream. But less than 6 months later, we got a unanimous vote on $15 an hour. This can happen. But it will require us to go through the pains of building independent. And I say pains because we are heading into months of arguing for, where we will hear arguments for lesser evilism. We've heard some of them today. We are going to hear them relentlessly. Our job is to debate honestly and respectfully. It is important to have respectful debates so that we can get our best political points across. And one of the aspects that we need to take into account, that we need to share with those who feel crushed by the weight of lesser evilism, that if, imagine if Jill Stein's campaign had not been, that did not exist right now as a pole of attraction for the left, what is going to happen? It's going to be all those voters who are angry at corporate politics will either stay at home and not vote or be driven towards Trump or a name that hasn't been mentioned this evening, Gary Johnson, the libertarian candidate. So we would have, had Jill Stein not been running and were we to not support that campaign, that leaves the field clear for the right wing. Why should the left cede the ground to the right? We have to occupy that ground and boldly convince people that we need to build a strong vote for Jill Stein in order to defeat the right. And the other question we have to pose to everybody so that people think seriously about this is, how on earth are we to fight against climate change? How on earth are we to fight for a racism and sexism and sexual violence free society? How are we to do any of this if we as a movement are unwilling to take this one step of building an independent party for the 99%? If we have aspirations to win that kind of society that we all have a vision for, that is a far cry. This is a small step on the way to achieving that kind of society. So we are not going to go anywhere close to that unless we actually have the courage to take on the most immediate question today, which is, what do we do as an alternative to corporate politics of both the Republicans and the Democrats? And the most important thing we have to remember is that we have to, at this moment, because the ecological clock of the planet is ticking so inexorably, it is incumbent upon us that we think seriously about where this society is going to go and not stay in our discussions and debates, not stay within the confines of capitalism, but really think about what capitalism offers and is that going to offer a solution. Capitalism, as many others have said, is a system that squanders untold wealth while there is increasing hunger, malnutrition, environmental destruction. It is a system that has incredible productivity, and yet we have stagnating or really declining living standards for more and more people. Let's not even talk about other countries. Let's talk about the US. This is the wealthiest country in the history of humanity. Look at the conditions that the majority of people are facing. Poverty rates are rising. Why should we accept this substandard system that reduces living beings and the planet to misery? As a human race, we should aim higher. We have to aim better than capitalism because it is possible for us to do that. And that is why Socialist Alternative does not accept that capitalism can be reformed. We are fighting for socialism. And what do we mean by socialism? We are talking about a society that is capable of harnessing all the technology and all this incredible productivity and creativity and ingenuity of human beings in order to satisfy the basic needs, but not just the basic needs, but provide a very high material standard of living for all living beings on the planet, and doing it in such a way that we move urgently towards an environmentally sustainable society away from fossil fuel and nuclear energy and towards safe, renewable energy society where we have mass transit and not traffic snarls, and where we have living wage jobs, health care, good quality, healthy food, safe neighborhoods, and all of the things, all of the aspects of life that we value, that we cherish as human beings. This is our right. It is up to us to fight for this. So what are the tasks for this year? I'll end on this, because this is the most important message that we need to take with us from now until November. What are the most important tasks that face us this year? We have to be absolutely clear that we are against the racist, anti-immigrant, misogynist, hateful politics of Donald Trump. We need to commit that we will build massive protest marches and rallies against Donald Trump in solidarity with Black Lives Matter, with the immigrant rights movement, with women's rights movement, against this hateful message. We need to march, we need to commit to march alongside black and brown activists fighting against police violence and brutality, fight for democratically elected bodies that can hold the police accountable, that have the full powers to hold police accountable, that bodies that can bring, democratically elected bodies that can bring killer cops to book. We have to debate respectfully with everybody who has fallen prey to lesser evilism, who has fallen prey to politics of fear, and put forward a very clear case for building a left alternative against the right wing. And most importantly of all, it is our task from now until November to help build the strongest possible vote for Jill Stein as the beginning of the basis for a party for the 99% solidarity.